Simon & Schuster Audio presents Star Trek Discovery, Desperate Hours by David Mack. Based on Star Trek and Star Trek The Next Generation, created by Gene Roddenberry, and Star Trek Discovery, created by Brian Fuller and Alex Kurtzman. Read by Susan Eisenberg.
For those fighting to keep the dream alive. Historian's note. The events of this story take place in May 2255, approximately 1 year before the Shenzhou's historic mission to the binary stars, and 1 year after the Enterprise's first mission to Talos IV. Justice and judgment lie often a world apart. Emmeline Pankhurst, British Suffragette. My Own Story, 1914. 1. God damn it! What now? John Bowen took the steps two at a time, climbing the switchback staircase as if it and his ass were on fire. The operations level was 4 flights up from his quarters, but he was winded after only 2. Most days he would have waited for the lift, but most days the Arcadia Explorer platform wasn't being hammered by a Cirsa III tropical maelstrom that caused its underwater drill to spew a flood of alarms. A trio of mechanics barreled past Bowen on their way down the stairs. He put his back to the wall to let them pass, since they were burdened with tools, cables, and bulky emergency gear. None of the tool pushers acknowledged him as they ran by. That suited him fine. Beads of sweat rolled from his thinning blonde hair and down his forehead while he caught his breath. As soon as the stairwell was clear, he continued his climb, swearing under his breath at the aching in his lower back, the cramping muscles in his thighs, and the lightness in his head. The closer he got to the top of the stairs, the more clearly he heard the platform's alert siren, a buzzing sonic assault that had been optimized by acoustic engineers to cut through the roar of howling winds and crashing waves. The deck was wet near the door that led outside, and the corridor to the operations center was steeped in the white noise of rain lashing the platform's exterior. Ignoring the flashing orange lights and continuing sirens, Bowen hurried down the narrow passage into the crowded confines of ops. Blue light from banks of displays contrasted with amber flashes from the emergency lights overhead. Crew members manned every duty station, a rarity in the middle of the night. Bowen headed for the center situation table and shouted, "What the hell's going on?" The night shift supervisor, Liwa Amalu, yielded her place at the situation table to Bowen, handing him the coordinator's headset as she stepped aside.
"The drill hit something."
"That's what it's for, isn't it?" Bowen said. Omalu pointed at a flashing error indicator on the master system display. "It's stuck." "Son of a bitch!" Bowen grumbled harsher profanities under his breath as he magnified the sensor image from the bottom of the drilling shaft. "What the hell stops a plasma drill?" "The same duranium-rich composite that drew us here in the first place." She pointed with one dark brown finger at a cross-section image of the seabed. "We'd just broken through the last sedimentary layer when the drill stopped dead." None of the numbers in the display made sense to Bowen. "So pull it out." "What part of stuck did you not understand?" Amalu noted Bowen's sharp glance and pulled back on the reins of her temper. "I got every tool pusher I can spare patching in backup power now. As soon as we reverse the drill free, I'll pull it up for a damage check and send down a probe to see what we've got."
"Sounds good."
Bowen let go of his own bad mood. This was just another night on the job, another routine snafu, nothing to get worked up about. "Will this storm be a problem?" Omalu glanced toward the wide transparent aluminum window at the south side of Ops, noted the lightning-strobed barrage of wind and rain that pummeled the Arcadian Explorer, then threw a skeptical look at Bowen. "You're kidding, right? It's just a rainstorm.
I used to sail through worse every summer when I was just a girl in Lagos.
That's what I thought. Just wanted to check.
He wondered if he would be able to get back to sleep if he returned to his quarters now, or if he should stay awake since daybreak was only a couple of hours away. He asked Omalu,
"Any coffee left in the kitchenette?"
"What do you think?"
"I think people on this rig need to learn that when you kill the Joe, you make some mo.
It's just common goddamn courtesy.
You know what I'm..."
The overhead lights went out as the deck heaved and pitched, throwing Bowen against the situation table. Omalu and half a dozen other members of the operations team tumbled and collided with one another against a bank of consoles. The buzzing alert was replaced by a whooping siren, and in an instant nearly every indicator on the master systems display turned condition critical red. Outside the southern window, a fireball erupted from one of the fuel pods, and a cargo crane swung away from the platform and plunged half its length into the sea. Bowen reached across the situation table to open an internal channel.
"Engineering, this is Ops. Status report."
All he heard was static. He switched to a different channel.
"Drill team, Ops. Report."
Dead silence. Omalu clawed her way back to Bowen's side. Did something hit us?
"How should I know?"
Bowen struggled to make sense of the chaos unfolding on all of the platform's situation monitors.
"We've got fires on sublevels 6 and 7. No readings at all below that."
He pivoted toward the drilling supervisor.
"Ramayan, what's happening?"
"Seismic activity directly beneath us," said the Mumbai-born drilling supervisor, his voice pitched from shouting over the din of alarms and an ominous rumbling that resonated through the platform's superstructure.
"Rapid rise in the seabed. It's pushing the drill back up into..."
His report was cut off by another explosion outside the window. The bent and fractured drill housing shot up through the platform, erupted from its roof, and triggered a cascade of structural failures. Bowen watched in horror as the center of the Arcadia Explorer vanished into the fresh cavity wrought by the expulsion of the massive drill assembly.
"Holy shit," Bowen muttered.
Louder, he demanded.
"Damage reports, now!"
First to respond was Omalu. "Rising seabed confirmed. All our support pylons have fractured." She patched in a feed from one of the exterior safety sensors. An image of the platform appeared over the situation table, revealing that the massive facility's two lowest levels had already collapsed and vanished into the churning water below, taking with them more than 200 personnel, including most of the engineers. The image tilted as the platform lurched again, knocking Bowen off his feet. Omalu white-knuckled the center table.
"If this rig shifts more than 6 meters in any direction, it's gonna sink."
Terror made a jumble of Bowen's thoughts. The Arcadia Explorer stood on pylons of duranium-reinforced thermoconcrete. They should have been impervious to any natural disaster this planet could dish out. Now the entire facility was moments away from vanishing beneath 2,400 meters of water. There was no time to effect repairs, and with most of the engineers already gone, there was no one to make them. Bowen had no choice. He pressed his palm against a biometric pad on the master system's display.
"Computer, sound the evacuation order. All decks."
"Confirmed," the computer replied in a masculine voice with a dry London accent. Bowen turned from the console and stood tall.
"Everyone, get the hell out of here. Get to a pod, a shuttle, anything. Move!"
The room cleared within seconds. Bowen had to nudge Omalu to get her away from the systems display.
"It's over, Liwa. We gotta go. Now."
They nearly fell over each other on the way to the nearest exit, and Ramayan Chandra was right behind them as they left Ops and charged outside into the storm. Omalu froze at a T-intersection in the catwalk. Bowen started to point her toward the right, but then Chandra pulled them both in the opposite direction.
"This way!"
Bowen protested.
"But the pods
are too far," Chandra said.
"The shuttle's closer. Come on."
The slender engineer took the lead and guided them through blinding sheets of rain that stung Bowen's face. Just as Chandra had promised, around the nearest corner was a narrow bridge to a landing platform where a shuttle was parked. The three of them ran toward it and fought to keep their footing as the rig shifted again. Omalu's feet slipped on the wet metal bridge, and she nearly plunged over the railing into a jumble of broken metal beams above a churning mass of black water. Bowen grabbed Omalu's shirt and pulled her back onto the bridge. "You all right?" Rain pelted her face as she nodded. He pulled her into motion, and they resumed their run toward the shuttle. Chandra reached the small craft first and threw himself into its pilot's seat. Omalu stayed behind to seal the hatch, while Bowen strapped himself into the shuttle's command seat. "Get us in the air," he snapped at Chandra, "before this..." Calamity preempted his warning. With a sound like thunder, the rig slid off its shattered pylons and tilted toward the sea. Outside the cockpit canopy, a nightmare unfolded. Entire sections of the rig sheared apart, spilling metal and bodies into the ocean. On other landing platforms, shuttles and other small spacecraft slid over the edges and sank into the raging sea. Feeling gravity take hold of his own shuttle, Bowen realized he was very likely witnessing a preview of his imminent fate. Ramayan!
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.